Somebody else, what's something that you began? And I want to go over this. Something that began, remember, I think we had that very closed experience in the church. And I preface all these things that I don't like it when we go, this is the church then and this is the church now, as if there was a different church then and there's a different. The Catholic Church is the Catholic Church. There is change throughout history, but it's the Catholic Church. I have a problem if we go, well, now this was all bad and now this is all good, okay? There's no such thing as that. The theology, the dogma of the church did not change. But if we go through history, practice, how we do what we do, that does change. And so we've experienced that, yes, we do things differently now, and there are reasons for that. But that doesn't make all of that bad because this is the way we do it now. But one of the things is mentioned over here, prayer groups. Following the Second Vatican Council, there is now this renewal in the church in which people are feeling freer, more open, more whatever. I mean, that was the experience for a lot of people. And out of that came the charismatic movement. Any of you here involved with the charismatic movement in the late 60s and early 70s? Okay, no, wow, not that many of you, okay. Well, you know, this is where prayer groups came. And when I got out of the Army and came back to Atlanta, somebody invited me to come to one of those, and so I went. And I'll never forget the experience. I was sitting there, and all of a sudden, people start raising their hands and singing hallelujah, hallelujah, and people start speaking in this funny language, and people start getting slain in the spirit, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm in a nut house. What happened? What happened in this place? So my initial experience with the charismatic movement was a very scary thing. And that would continue on for quite a while. I remember when I was a deacon in parish in Sheridan, Wyoming, and the pastor, Monsignor Delaney, and he used to have these charismatic masses, and they'd have this being slain in the spirit. And I remember sitting in the back pew and watching this and being so angry at him about giving into this crap. How could you be doing this kind of thing, you know? And so it's been decades of progression for me to understand that. But it was a very powerful kind of thing. And what it was basically that belief, you know, that the Spirit, what we read in Scripture in the Acts of the Apostles, the Holy Spirit coming down upon us, and what comes from that. St. Paul speaks about that, speaks about the gifts of the Spirit, but also speaks about, you know, speaking in tongues and being slain, that really isn't crazy stuff. We may have problems understanding it, but it's the action of the Spirit. Now, one of the dangerous things, though, that happened with that, and I think we've gotten well beyond this now, thank goodness, was, and I experienced this particularly where I was in Sheridan, Wyoming, is that we started getting into this old heresy that goes way back to the beginning centuries of the church that said, I have more of the Spirit in me than you. I'm holier than you are. I'm more enlightened than you are. I'm better than you are religiously. And that sometimes would happen in this charismatic movement, that if you weren't charismatic, if you didn't speak in tongues, if you didn't get slain in the Spirit, then there must be something wrong with you. You must be possessed by evil or something, and so you're not that good. And the opposite side of that was, there are a number of people I knew in the early movement of the charismatic movement who left the church and went on to start their own churches. So rather than bringing unity, it brought disunity, which is contrary to what the Holy Spirit is all about. Again, I believe we've gone far beyond that now. But that was some of the reaction, I think, where we had gone from a very closed kind of experience to a very open kind of experience. All right. Anybody else? What's something that you began? What's your experience, your feeling? Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Please don't take offense at this, but how old are you? What age are you?
I'm
Okay, all right, okay, okay, thank you. No, I'm asking that question. You look great. I'm asking that question for this reason, okay? Because you're a decade behind. We had the experience of the Baltimore Catechism, which, again, for any of us who, I think here it didn't matter whether you went through Catholic school or CCD, as we called it at that time. You had the Baltimore Catechism every year, and it was about question and answer and memory, etc. And for all that we knock it, at least it laid a foundation of something because it was in your mind. And it, what, you know what I'm trying? But then in reaction to that, in many of our, not all, but many of our religious education programs, we threw that aside and basically went to like an experience talked here where it was about just love and making banners and doing things. Now, there's nothing wrong because what we've learned in our religious education program, right, over the years is it's not about all memory and it's not all about question and answer and it's not all about just making banners and doing. It's both. It's experience and expression. It's how we put that together. But we went through kind of a reaction to now we're just going to love. I've had many people who are generationally just behind my generation say, I got nothing from my religious education. I couldn't tell you anything about the Catholic Church. I never really had any dogma whatsoever. All I heard about was love, 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 love. And so there is a generation there, particularly people in perhaps from right now, maybe 45 to 50 to 60, et cetera, or 45 to 58 or 50. Anyway, somewhere in that thing who a number of them will say, I just never really got anything. Okay. Because we went in a different direction. So, you know, it's the reality that both come together. I can learn every question in the Baltimore Catechism and memorize every answer and know them backwards and forwards. I can make Sister proud when the bishop asks me the questions, okay? But it doesn't necessarily mean that I have faith. I'm good at memory, okay? It's got to be both. We learn, we come to understand, but we also put that together with how we express what we understand and what we believe. All right?